This is a 1950 Jaguar Mark V. I just bought it. It's powered, or was powered, by a 3.5-liter inline six-cylinder engine. But soon, it will be powered by this. Is a Tesla Model 3 rear drive unit. The whole subframe, actually, and the battery. For my next trick, I will be joining these two in holy motrimony. Motormony. The 3.5-liter is the big engine for this car. They also did a 2.5-liter that made around 100 horsepower, but the 3.5 makes a whopping 125 horsepower, probably measurably less at the wheels. This is the least powerful Tesla you can buy, actually the least powerful thing Tesla has ever made, aside from maybe that CyberQuad thing. It's good for about 283 horsepower, probably plenty for a car that doesn't even have seatbelts. Sure, I could go with a dual motor performance setup, but frankly, I'm pretty happy with the idea of just under 300 horsepower. There are actually some advantages to this setup. I can use the smaller battery for one. Specifically the mid-range plus battery. This gives me about 54 kilowatt hours of power. It's lighter and less expensive than the large battery. It weighs about 180 pounds less than the big battery. My goal with the weight of this vehicle is to keep it below the original Jaguar weight of 3,675 pounds. This is not going to be super easy since I'm adding 1,000 pounds of stuff to it, but the lighter battery will help. The battery has fewer cells, that's why it weighs less and has less power. I'm not entirely sure how Tesla accomplishes this. I'm hoping the modules are physically smaller so it will be easier to package in here, but I'm betting that's not the case. A quick internet search found no standard battery teardown pictures, so I'll just have to open it up and find out. I'm betting they're using the same plastic modules with the cells removed at evenly spaced intervals. This would allow them to use one part for the modules, which is always better, and that way they could maintain the weight distribution and inertia of the car so they don't have to change any suspension or anything else. I'm not sure where I'm going to put the batteries on this car quite yet, or for that matter how I'm going to repackage them. I could put them maybe in the back, spreading between the trunk and under the rear seat, but the problem with that is I just took out a giant front motor and transmission from the front of the car, so there's basically no weight on the front axle, and if I add all that weight to the rear, this thing is just going to wheelie around everywhere, which actually sounds kind of awesome. But no, we're not going to do that. Probably what I can do is run a couple of them between the frame rails, and maybe I could stick a couple of them in the incredibly long engine bay. The weight might end up being rear biased, maybe between 55 and 60% rear. This is actually better than a 50-50 weight distribution. It always bothers me when people say 50-50 is ideal, or they say something like, this car has a perfect 50-50 weight distribution. Your tires get the most grip when they're evenly loaded. This is why you want a low center of gravity. You don't want all your weight going to the left side tires when you take a right-hand turn. Same thing forward and back. Going around a corner, 50-50 is ideal, but you're not always going around a corner. Sometimes you're accelerating, sometimes you're slowing down. When you're accelerating, you want more weight on the tires that are doing the accelerating, or at least enough so that they don't spin. This is a problem with front-wheel drive cars, because as soon as you hit the gas, all the weight transfers to the rear off the driven wheels. When you're slowing down, all your weight shifts to the front. So if you start with more weight on the rear tires, your weight distribution gets more evenly loaded as you slow down. So in braking, you want more weight on the rear. In cornering, you want 50-50. And if you have a rear-wheel drive car, you'll want a little more weight on the rear tires for traction. So 2 out of 3 times, rear is better. If you're always driving in a circle at a constant speed, then 50-50 is ideal. But if you ever plan on slowing down or accelerating, a rear weight bias is better. The motor packaging is going to be pretty easy. See, I'm going to take this entire rear subframe with brakes and motor and suspension and everything, and I'm just going to shove it up under the Jag. I could do some sort of thing with a motor in the front and a drive shaft going back to the rear end, but that's a bad idea for a lot of reasons. First off, the suspension and brakes on this thing are over 70 years old. Best I can tell, they were designed in a shed in Coventry by two drunk blokes who had a vague understanding of automotive engineering, in the same way that Arby's has a vague understanding of food. I used to work with a bunch of British automotive engineers who gave me the impression that England had a long history of automotive engineering, but it seems that in 1950 they were about as far along as the United States in automotive engineering, which is to say, developing. The Brits would always say, let's use aluminium, we should use aluminium here, and I would say, no, let's use aluminum, aluminium is expensive, we have to import it from England, and then I'd laugh and nobody else would. Good times. All new brakes, all new suspension are going on this Jag. In the rear, the absolute easiest and cheapest way to do that is to take the whole rear subframe assembly and bolt it under the frame. There are four mounting points, so I just have to line it up under the car and sort of weld up some mounts where the bolt holes line up. This probably sounds easier than it is. A quick look at the Jaguar frame makes it look like I'm gonna have to cut some of the frame away to get the mounts in. The subframe actually looks like it would fit really easily backwards, and I have considered mounting it backwards and just driving in reverse all the time, but I'm sure there's some good reasons not to do that. I don't know what they are, but I feel like there probably are. I drew up a lot of this stuff in CAD, and I tried packaging the Tesla springs and dampers in the rear, but it was gonna take some complex bell cranks and angled mounting, so I'm just gonna use some coilovers. The front end is getting new brakes and suspension too. I considered taking the front brakes and suspension off of a Model 3, but the problem is the Model 3 doesn't have all of the suspension arms connected to one subframe in the front like they do in the back. Also, they have this thing with the upright where it curves over the top of the tire. This puts the upper control arm really high. That's a no-go for the Jag because it's got this separate fender and hood thing, so the upper control arm would actually blow through the outside of the car. I did think about cutting off the upper control arm and sort of bolting or mounting some sort of lower upper control arm ball joint. I know a little bit about suspension kinematics, so I could probably make this work. If I had bought a wrecked Model 3 and pulled all the powertrain parts out and had those parts, I probably would have done this, but I didn't. I just bought what I needed from a salvage yard. So I'm gonna do something different. I'm gonna use a Mustang II front end, not exactly a Mustang II front end, but some aftermarket stuff that meets the Mustang II kinematics. This is super common on hot rods. Back in, I don't know, the 80s or something, somebody figured out they could go to a junkyard and rip out the front suspension from a Mustang II and stick it on their 1940 whatever Ford. Well, it caught on so much that now there are dozens of companies that sell hundreds of different Mustang II kits for all sorts of different cars. The cool thing is there's a huge aftermarket, and you can also go to the junkyard and pull parts. So basically anywhere on the spectrum from rusty junkyard thing to shiny chrome stainless thing that's really expensive, you can find. I'll be going somewhere in the middle, and I'll be changing up the suspension points a little bit to mate up with what's already on the Jag. The Mustang II front end is, in fairness, not perfect, but it's pretty good, and especially considering the fact that I can just buy a bunch of stuff off the shelf and I don't have to fabricate or design a whole bunch of stuff, makes it a lot easier. This thing's never gonna handle like brand new BMW, so it's probably good enough. There are a handful of companies that will sell you controllers to control the Model S and Model X motors, but there's only one so far that sells a controller to control the Model 3, Enginext. There are also a couple other companies that are working on something. There's a guy who's coincidentally just a couple of miles from me named Phil. He's supposed to have something in Q1 or Q2. I hate it when people say Q1 or Q2 because it always means Q3 or Q4. In any case, I sent my stuff off to Enginext and they're gonna help me hack into this thing and make it work on this car. The interior is in pretty good shape, except for that it's so old it will disintegrate if you look at it wrong. I sat in the seat when I first got it and immediately tore a hole in it, but maybe I just need to lay off the Oreos. The seats are gonna get replaced, and I'm probably honestly gonna do something that's a little bit different than something that just looks like recovering the old seats. These things are the old, springy, uncomfortable seats. There's no headrest, and they'd probably crumble like a potato chip in a crash. Also, I'd like to add seat belts because, you know, safety. The dashboard on these things looks awesome, and I'd love to clean it up and just leave it as it is. I think it would be pretty cool to open up the gauges and put in some stepper motors so that the RPMs would show correct RPMs for the motor, and maybe the fuel gauge will show me how much electricity I have left. I would love to make this car comfortable enough to daily drive. I don't want to go too far with it, but I'm going to replace all the seals. I'm going to add some sound deadening material, some comfortable seats. I'm probably going to add air conditioning because I probably need to put an air conditioning pump in anyway to keep the motor and battery cool, and so I might as well just have that work. Then I could buy a PTC heater, a high voltage heater. It should actually be pretty easy to make it a nice, comfortable daily car. I'm not super sure what I'm gonna do with the outside or with the paint, but I'm kind of kicking around the idea of going for like a style of an American car around this time, a chop the top, flat black paint job, shine up the chrome. I think it would be kind of cool on a fancy British car. But most of that stuff comes later. First thing first, we gotta get the powertrain in and get it driving. So that's about it. It's gonna be a fun project. I'm not sure exactly how long it's gonna take. I should be done, we'll say Q1 or Q2. Next week, we'll take a look at the Jaguar itself because it's very interesting. Automotive engineering has improved a lot since 1950. A lot. What will I build next? I don't know. I do know, actually, it's right in there. But if you wanna find out, hit that subscribe button and follow along. Be sure to like and share and all that other stuff, and I'll see you next time.